wearing your thinking hats. Thinking hats. I'm going to ask you to think. Not a lot, initially. Towards the end, I'm going to ask you to think. Okay? So we're still looking at Melchizedek as a type of Jesus Christ. Okay? Points the way towards Jesus. Let me review a little bit here before we get started. I want to add an additional thought about where we closed last week. But we're discussing that if Melchizedek is so inferior, how can he serve as a type? Do you remember I said that last week? Because he is inferior to what he's pointing the way to, correct? Since he's pointing the way to Jesus Christ. So if he's inferior, how can he serve as the type? But I stated that God always uses an inferior one to serve as a type because of what the type is pointing at. Remember? What's Melchizedek point at? He's pointing at Jesus Christ. Thus, he's going to be inferior, even though the writer in Hebrews is pointing out how he is, how he points towards Christ. Still going to be inferior. And then, and remember we looked at that Melchizedek isn't really eternal. Because if he was eternal, then he wouldn't be a type. What would he be? If he was eternal, he would be what is pointed at, and he's not. He's, and I use the visualization that Melchizedek is a picture of the landscape. He is not the landscape. Okay, in that regards, in that analogy, Jesus Christ would be the analogy. Melchizedek really is a poor substitute, but the Holy Spirit is desiring to show Christ as a priest. The purpose of Hebrews 7 is the Holy Spirit is trying to show the Jewish people that Christ is a priest better than Aaron. Okay? And he's going to show that this Melchizedek priesthood is better than the Aaronic priesthood. And that because Jesus, we are told in the scripture that Jesus is a priest after the order of Melchizedek, okay? And that's the whole thing. Jesus is not a national priest, as Aaron would have been. He's a universal priest. He's not a priest who is subject to kings. He's a king unto himself. He's Aaron and those priests were unable to bring about righteousness and peace. Okay, remember we talked about that? Their ability to bring righteousness and peace lasted how long? Until the sinner sinned again. Okay, we're going to look at that in a much greater detail towards the end if we get time. But Melchizedek is described as having no birth because the writer of Hebrews and the writer of Genesis, who wrote all those many years apart, want you to see that that the priesthood of Melchizedek is not hereditary in nature, as the priesthood of Aaron was. You know, you had to be in the tribe of Levi, and you had to be able to show that you were in direct lineage of Aaron. That's not the case with Melchizedek and Jesus. Instead of being hereditary in nature, Jesus Christ and Melchizedek were qualified to be priest. Why? Because of their personal quality. They had unique personal qualities, and that their priesthood is not timed. We talked about how in the Aaronic priesthood, priests at the age of 25, they became priest assistants for 5 years. At the age of 30, they began to serve as priests, and at the age of 50, they were retired. Okay. The Melchizedek priesthood is eternal in nature. And just one other thought then before I close this area. It says, look in Hebrews 7 in 3. It says, I want you to watch this, that he is, it says, it's an important point. It's a strong point in reference to the superiority of Melchizedek, I'm going to get messed up. I printed my lesson on front and back, and I never do that. So if I look like I'm lost, that's probably because I am. But remember, we talked about it in verse 3, it says that he was made like the Son of God. Remember? He was made like the Son of God. And a lot of people think the most important part there is that he was made like the Son of God. But that's not really the most important part. You know what the most important part is? The most important part is who's first. If he was made like the Son of God, who's first? The Son of God. Melchizedek was made like Jesus before Jesus was on the scene. Okay? And the part, the like part is still important, but it does not say that the Son of God was made like Melchizedek. So we know who came first in your outline. The words are Son of God. Melchizedek was made like the Son of God. He was not the Son of God. He was made like him. Jesus Christ, then, is the original priest of the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek is really a copy of Jesus, if you want to think about it. And it's important to understand this because the writer of Hebrews is trying to show the Jews how Melchizedek is superior to the priesthood. So the next thing I want you to look at, then, is that how these superiorities of Melchizedek are proven. And this runs from verse 4 through verse 10. So stay with me in those verses. There's a lot of words in there, but it's basically a very simple argument. We have proof that Melchizedek is superior to Aaron and Levi here. And this is good for you to understand. I can tell you that the Melchizedek priesthood is superior to Aaron. And you can believe me if you want, but here's the proof. It's important that when you speak to people, you can speak to people of proof. First of all, the number one thing. We're trying to prove that Melchizedek is superior to Aaron and the priesthood, okay? First of all, Abraham gave Melchizedek a tithe. Who's superior? Melchizedek. Abraham gave him a tithe. In verse 4, it says, "Now consider how great this man was," meaning Melchizedek, "to whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils." So that means that Melchizedek is something. Okay? Even the patriarch, that's two Greek words, archis means... first, and patre means father. He's the so what does that mean? Abraham's name is in Greek. He is the first father, but Melchizedek is better than him. The first father. Why is Abraham called the first father? He's the father of the Jewish nation. Correct. The first father gave Melchizedek tithes. Okay, so that proves that Melchizedek is superior to Abraham. And it says, Abraham gave him a tenth of the spoils. So Abraham, who's the number one Jew, as the Jews are reading what is written in Hebrews, Abraham, the number one guy in their religious focus, gave Melchizedek a tithe. You know, for a Jew, nobody's better than Abraham. You know, really, he is. Moses and Abraham, they're at the top of the faith. So it's a pretty heavy point. It's a pretty strong argument that you can make in regards to the superiority of Melchizedek. Now, if you go back to the second verse, it says that Abraham, in the second part, it also talks about the tithe, whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, it says. Now, the Holy Spirit in this argument shows that, again, that Melchizedek is greater than Abraham because he wants to show you that he's greater than Aaron and he's greater than Levi, okay? And the point being that is Abraham greater than Aaron and Levi? Yes. As the founder of Judaism, he is greater than Aaron and Levi. Therefore, if Melchizedek's better than Aaron, that means he he's also better than Aaron and Levi? Correct? Okay, so if he's better than Aaron and Levi, if he's better than Aaron and Levi and Abraham, then he's the mediator of a better covenant. And for a Jew, that means one thing. You should turn from Judaism and turn to who? Jesus Christ. Get out of that dead religion. So just stay with me for a minute here. I can't, you know, when I look at the Word of God, I have to declare the whole counsel of the Word of God to you. How often do I talk to you about tithing? I don't know. I think I taught on tithing like 2.5 years ago for 2 weeks. But if the Word of God speaks of tithing, then I have to speak of it. But I trust the Spirit of God, and I know how you will take it. It says Abraham gave this guy Melchizedek, he says a tenth of the spoils. That word that is translated spoils in English is akrophenion. Akrophenion in the Greek. And it comes from two Greek words. Akron. The akron is the highest point. Okay. So that's the first part of the word. The highest point. And then phis, which in this tense is translated to phinion, means a heap. Highest point on the heap. Okay? That's what it means. That word spoils in the Greek means the highest point on the heap. It's what's on top of the heap. So when Abraham gave to Melchizedek, what did he give him? He gave him the very best. You know, we're in present-day Christianity, we're wrapped up in 10%. The Old Testament isn't wrapped up in 10%. It's wrapped up in giving the best, the top of the heap. The emphasis wasn't on 10%. The emphasis is on the top of the heap. You know, when the Greeks would go out and conquer a country, you know what they would do? They would come back and they would march up the Acropolis. And on the Acropolis, you have the Parthenon, the temple to Diana. You have all these temples. And in the middle, you had this big courtyard. And they would take everything they brought home, because that's what they would do. When they defeated a country, they came back with everything they could carry. And they would come home and they would pile it in a big heap. And the top, the very best, you know what they did? They gave it to their gods. Okay? It's kind of the same idea here. That's what Abraham. Remember, Abraham went out and beat up these kings, remember? These kings had been out doing what? They had been taking everybody else's money. Abraham, when he attacked them, he scared them so bad, they ran away and left everything behind. Abraham got all that money. And when he had all that money, he gave the best, the top of the heap, he gave it to Melchizedek. And that is then, that amplifies, that magnifies for you the greatness of Melchizedek. Abraham was the great father of the Jewish religion, the first father. So when you consider that then, consider how great Melchizedek must have been. So go to verse 5. Look at verse 5. The argument goes on in verse 5. And indeed, those who are the sons of Levi, who receive the priesthood, have a commandment to receive tithes from the people according to the law. That is, from their brethren, though they have come from the loins of Abraham. Interesting point. The point of the writer here, as you look at it, there's a couple of things. He says, they're the sons of Levi who receive the office of priesthood. Not all the sons of Levi received it, just the ones specifically. And by law, by command, they're commanded to get tithes, right? The people are, the heave offering, they throw it over the altar. Why do they throw it over the altar? Well, you can't put it on the altar. What happens to the heave offering? It feeds the priest. If you put it on the altar, you're going to burn it up. They used to throw it over the altar and the priest would collect the food, and that's how they would eat, because priests didn't work. The expectation with the priest was one thing and one thing only, to serve God 24/7. So they would receive this food. So the idea, so the comparison then is then, okay, here's the Aaronic priesthood. There was a commandment that the people had to feed them. and here's Melchizedek. Did Abraham have a commandment to give tithes to Melchizedek? No. You know why? Because he's so great, there needed to be no commandment. That's why. Okay? There wasn't even a commandment to give tithes to Melchizedek. Melchizedek, by his presence, by his own personal quality, Abraham automatically recognizes the need to give him a tithe. And he doesn't just give him 10%, he gives him the very best. The top of the heap is what he gives you. So, he doesn't say, hey, Abraham, give me some tithe. Doesn't say that anywhere in the Word. Abraham acknowledges who he is, and he gives him from the top of the heap. So the Levites exacted from the people what the law said, but this man, because of his personal, in your outline, the word is quality of his life. His quality of life set the inference in the words in Hebrews 7:5 is that the quality of Melchizedek's life set a commandment upon Abraham to give to Melchizedek. He didn't say anything, but only by being who he was, Abraham recognized him as a priest of the Most High God. Remember, we spoke about that earlier. And thus he gave him the respect he deserved as God's priest. So again, Melchizedek's greatness is shown because Abraham paid him tithes when he didn't have to. There wasn't any law back then, was there? Okay. You still with me? Okay. I think you're all awake. That's kind of a little bit unusual, but that's okay. You're doing good. Second principle. Melchizedek blessed Abraham. That's something. A lot of people were blessed by Abraham, but this is the only other person that I've ever read of in the Bible that blessed Abraham. God blessed Abraham. But this is the only other person. Look at verse 6. It says in 6, but those whose genealogy is not derived from them receive tithes from Abraham. That's another phrase that means Melchizedek. He whose genealogy is not derived from them, it says he received tithes from Abraham and blessed him who had the promises. Melchizedek blessed Abraham, the one who has the promises. So here's a Melchizedek. We don't have a chronology of him. We don't have a genealogy like we do of all these other guys. But he's so much greater, he's able to bless them. And look in verse 7. And beyond all contradiction, that's a very important phrase, it says, and beyond all contradiction, that means you cannot refute this. This is the absolute truth, he says, the writer. The lesser is blessed by the better. Who's the lesser? Abraham. The better, Melchizedek, is the one who blesses him. Okay? The writer wants you to make sure that you understand who the lesser is and who the better is. In other words, Melchizedek must have been greater than Abraham because he blessed Abraham, correct? And that's a great argument. The principle is simply this. God operated in Melchizedek's life on the basis of his personal qualifications, and because of that, he was higher than Abraham in those qualifications. Melchizedek, you can think of Melchizedek as a holier man than Abraham. And Abraham was a pretty holy guy. Okay? He had his ups and downs, but we all did. So he was chosen to bless Abraham. So if this man was greater than Abraham, then the rationale then is if he's greater than Abraham, he's greater than anything that came from Abraham. So the third argument then that the writer gives is that because all priests came from where? Abraham. From the loins of Abraham. Look at verse 8. Here, mortal men receive tithes, but there he receives them, of whom it was witnessed that he lives. Okay? Here, men receive, he's talking about the Aaronic priesthood, they receive tithes, men who die, is another way to think of it. But Melchizedek's of the eternal priesthood type. He lives, in other words, he's able to, those of the dying priesthood, of the Aaronic priesthood, could exact tithes. How much greater than Melchizedek, who has no death as a type, it's not that he's eternal, who has no death as a type, as a priest like Jesus Christ, who lives forevermore, he receives them, of whom it is witnessed that he lives. He lives is the important. He's a greater priest. Why? Why is Melchizedek a greater priest? And Jesus Christ is of the order of Melchizedek because he lives. His nature is one of eternal. He's not a dying priest. He's a living priest. So Christ is a priest of a better priesthood. Okay? Universal, royal. He can bring about righteousness and peace. He has great personal qualifications. He's eternal. Okay? So sit there for a minute. Take a deep breath. Okay? Listen to these words from Hebrews 4:14. Open your heart and listen to these words. Seeing then that we have a great high priest, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Do you really understand those words? What that says? Let me read that again for us. Seeing then that we have this great high priest, okay? Now 4:14 is written before chapter 7, but still, chapter 7 shows us who this great high priest is. Let us therefore come before the throne of grace. How? We're supposed to come before boldly, that we may obtain mercy and find grace in your time of need. Why would we not seek out the Lord in our time of need? And yet, oftentimes I talk to Christians who are in turmoil in their life, and I'll ask them, have you prayed? And they tell me no. They're so wound up in their problems that they forget about that. So I'm going to take this all one step further. So now you've got to put on your thinking hats. I want us to get the big picture and the main point here. Throughout the study, so far I've stressed, I think I have one more week on this, and then I'm going to be teaching on temptation again Sunday morning, and then I'm probably going to move part of that study to Wednesday night until I finish it, and I'm almost done with that too. But we've been talking about how the Holy Spirit is speaking to the Jews in the context of Hebrews 7, correct? That's what I've been talking about. Now I want you to get the big picture of Christ's superior priesthood over the Old Testament priest of the tribe of Levi. This is the big picture. Now whenever you read scripture, I always tell you the same thing. When you see the word therefore, it's a very, very important word. Look at 7:25. In 7:25, it says, therefore. So everything that has preceded up to that point is pointing towards 7:25. All this stuff about Melchizedek and Jesus being of that priesthood, all of that now. So the main point up to that point is 7:25. This is the thesis statement, okay? If you were in class, we used to have tell our kids, you need to underline the thesis statement with this color ink or whatever. What does it say in 7:25? It says, therefore, he is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. I don't know if you've ever considered that word always. It's a very, very important word up to this point, you know, this Melchizedek stuff is pretty complex. It's kind of difficult to understand if you don't have a real grasp of it. Yeah, it can be kind of overwhelming. But this 25th verse is pretty easy, at least initially. It has three parts to it, okay? The first part, Christ, it says, he is able to save to the uttermost. Do you know what the word uttermost means in the word? It just means,
Forever.
Whenever you read uttermost, in your own head, just say, forever. So it says then, Jesus is able to save forever. That is a great promise. That's a promise from the Word of God. Jesus is able to save you forever. And then it says, he always, and at the end of that verse, it says that he always lives to make intercession for us. Okay? And then in between that, he saves us forever. He always lives. He always lives. Consider that word always. To make intercession for us. And in between so you have the all eternal salvation and eternal intercession. Did you know that? Christ is interceding for you right now at this particular moment. Eternal salvation, eternal intercession. And all you have to do for that is that you have to be one who comes to God through him. Who's him? Jesus Christ. Okay? So, eternal salvation, eternal intercession, if you're willing to come to God through Jesus Christ. So, think about the relationship then between those first two. Christ is able to save forever, and Christ always lives to make intercession for you. Christ lives to make intercession to you. What's the connection? It's pretty explicit, really, and it's very important that he is able to save forever. Why? Why is Christ able to save you forever? What's the second part? He lives doing what? Because Christ can only save you forever because he always lives interceding for you. If he stopped interceding for you, there's a very bad implication there. Did you know that? Now he's never going to stop interceding, is he? But there's a very bad implication if he did, okay? Since he always lives to make intercession for us. In other words, our future eternal salvation hangs on the fact that Christ will always eternally intercede for us. Okay? Will he always intercede for you? There is no way that he will not. If you come to God through him, there's no way that he will not. So don't get wound up, the pastor's saying we can lose our salvation. That's not what I just said. What I said is that he's always interceding for you. And that interceding is what saves you eternally. Let me show you that. There's two huge things of what good theological Bible studying Christian folks, what are you being saved from? Give me a revelation. What happens in Revelation? The wrath of God. That is what you're being saved. So it answers the question that what you need to be saved from, like Gordy says, the consequences of our sin is the wrath of God. But I want to be clear about it, especially when you talk to a, hey man, what's this Jesus stuff? What are you talking about being saved? What do you mean by being saved? Well, how do you answer that? Are you explicit? Do you say, when we mean you're being saved, you are saved from the wrath of God? And then they say, whoa. What's the wrath of God? Then you can tell them what is the wrath of God? It's eternal damnation. It opens the door. If you know the answer to the first question, what does it mean to be saved? What are you being saved from? Would you like to be saved from the wrath of God? It opens the whole door to a gospel presentation. It's one of the easiest ways to present the gospel. So, you know, because you go to somebody that don't know the word and you use the word salvation, they don't know what you're talking about. You use the word saved. You know, from a biblical context, you know, they don't know what you're talking about. So you have to be able to explicitly tell them. And the words that they come to their mind aren't Bible words when you say salvation and saved. So we need to be clear about what the Bible means. And according to this verse, there's a connection between eternal salvation and eternal intercession. Okay? What's that connection? Okay, amen. So to be saved forever, then we need Christ to intercede for us forever with God. That's the implication, is it not? Or am I reading it wrong? If I'm reading it wrong, tell me. Somebody tell me. Because I don't want to teach you the wrong thing. But it says because he always lives to intercede for us, we are eternally saved. Am I wrong or right? I reworded it backwards, the implication is that we're eternally saved, and what are we saved from? We're saved from God. Now you say, oh man, you can't say that. Well, I can, and I'll show you how I can. Specifically, we need to be saved from the wrath of God that burns against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. Somebody read Romans 1:18. Romans 1:18, somebody read that for us.
Problem in the world.
main problem in the world is that mankind has to be reconciled to God. And if he's not reconciled to God, then there will be terrifying wrath. So if we can start reconciling people to God, what happens? Everything gets better. There are stories of revivals in Ireland, the Welsh revival, in cities where there's one town, it was a big dance, a school dance. All the kids were at the dance, and they had been drinking, and they were carousing around. And this revival started in this village, and one of the kids somehow was drawn to the local church. And he received a blessing of the Holy Spirit and went back to the dance. And he started bringing kids back to the church. And one by one, the Spirit started moving in these kids' life. And they, after a while, all the kids, not 50% of them, not 80% of them, every kid at the dance was at the church. And then they went home and they started getting their parents. They started bringing all their parents. Some of the kids, the boys, went to the bar to get their dad. They took them to the revival. You know what happened? Those bars closed. The next day, those bars were out of business. You know what? Those bars have never reopened. The bars that were closed that night never reopened. That's what happens when you have a Holy Ghost-led revival. Okay? That's how... It talks about people fall. The Holy Spirit was so thick that it was like people would walk into rooms and they would just fall down and they would be unconscious for 30 or 40 minutes. I'm not talking about being charismatic. I'm talking about the Spirit indwelling people to such a degree that it caused them to be unconscious. There's writings, if you've ever read the life of John Wesley, great Methodist minister, the father of the Methodist religion. It talks about him preaching in these fields, and during his sermon, people would just start passing out. Not because it was hot or anything. The Holy Spirit would start moving, and there would be thousands of people unconscious in these fields as the Spirit swept through. That's a revival. We're kind of scared of those things. So the major problem of the world is to escape this God, wrath of God, and to be reconciled to God so that that terrifying wrath won't happen. And that's the main problem. And the biblical, so what was the Old Testament answer on how to be reconciled to God? Right, the priesthood. How could you be reconciled? Bring your lamb, give it to the priest, be sacrificed, and then you were good. Until you sinned again. Until you left, usually not long. But now, there's a superior priesthood, and it's of the order of Melchizedek, and it's Jesus Christ. In the Old Testament, the priest needed to intercede with God for the nation Israel. They entered into the holy place where the regular people weren't allowed to go. They made sacrifice for the sins, so they were forgiven. And that priestly, that system was meant to teach you and to me today about our sin. Okay? Can you avoid sin in your life 100%? No. Just as those people couldn't. It's meant to teach us about our holiness, to teach us about the wrath of God and the inescapable judgment that's coming to everyone. And the point of all this then is God has made a way for you to be right with God tonight. God has made a way for everyone to be right with Him. Tonight, he has provided priests he's made the Old Testament priests, they're kind of like faded away in gray, and he's provided a new final priest who is his son, Jesus Christ, and he's bright. He's like a light. He's like the sun coming up in the morning. So the reason for all this talk about, the reason why the writer of Hebrews has gone through all this dissertation about Christ's relationship to Melchizedek in verses 1 through 24 of chapter 7 of Hebrews is because he's showing you the eternal, superior priesthood of Jesus, who is the only hope for eternal salvation. God's wrath never changes. God is going to have his wrath. You can't stop that, correct? God will have his wrath. There's only one hope for every sinner in the world. Only one hope. We have to have a faithful high priest. Without a faithful high priest who's going to intercede for us forever, we won't make it. And this is how he's described in verse 2. He's the King of righteousness. He's also called the King of peace. We need someone who has no beginning and no end. That's how he's described in the third verse. Someone who has an indestructible life. That's how he's described in the 16th verse. Someone that will never die. Someone that will never be replaced. That's what it says in 23 and 24. We need somebody greater than Abraham. We need somebody greater than Levi. We need somebody that's something like Melchizedek, who's a picture, who's a type. We need somebody who blessed Abraham, as it says in 6 and 7, who received tithes from Abraham, in a sense, from Levi, who was still in Abraham's loins. We need a new priest. We need a greater priest. So much greater that verse 11 says that there was no perfection through the Levitical priesthood, that all the Old Testament priesthood could do was point towards a superior priest after the order of Melchizedek. That's what Psalm 110:4 speaks of. The Lord has sworn and he will not relent. You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. Someone who made a sacrifice for you. What did he sacrifice? He didn't sacrifice an unblemished lamb. What did he sacrifice? He sacrificed the unblemished lamb, the Son of God, who now makes eternal intercession. And he guarantees, because of his ability to eternally intercede for you, he guarantees you eternal salvation. Okay? So the first implication of that 25th verse, 7:25, is all this truth about the priesthood is because we need to be saved from the wrath of God. And God's way of solving that problem is the priesthood. In this instance, the priesthood of Jesus Christ. That is not you. You don't get to figure that out. God has figured that out for you. God does all that for you. He's done it. He's already ordained a priest. It doesn't matter if you don't have to recognize Jesus Christ as your priest. He is the high priest. What you recognize is immaterial. He is the high priest. Don't make a mistake. Don't get the idea. It's not as though Jesus the priest loves you and God the Father doesn't love you. Okay? Because that's not the point. God the Father, who ordained the priesthood? God the Father. You know why? Because he loves you. Who sent his own son to be the high priest? God the Father. Who sent his son to die on the Christ? God the Father. God the Father loves you infinitely. It's immeasurable. And his way of rescuing you from his wrath is to send his son, because God's justice has to be vindicated. God is just. If you're a sinner, there has to be a price paid. You pay it or Jesus pays it, one way or the other. But there has to be a price paid. And then the last section, I hope, is our salvation. So what I'm inferring here is that our salvation depends on the work of Christ forever and ever, because that's what it says in this verse. The second great implication is that our future depends on the active work of Christ. Christ is actively, it's not on just his past work on the cross. It's not on our past decisions and commitment. It says that Christ is able to save forever, since he always lives to make intercession for us. In other words, he would not be able to save us forever if he did not keep interceding for you forever. That's why your sins are forgiven even in the future tense, because he's still interceding for you. You have been covered by his blood. Will he ever stop interceding? No. So you cannot lose that interceding nature. This means our salvation is as your salvation is as secure as the priesthood of Jesus Christ. And the priesthood of Jesus Christ is indestructible. That's why we need a priest who's so great. He's greater than any human. He's greater than Melchizedek. He's greater than Levi. Christ's deity secures his indestructible priesthood for us. That means that we should, listen, that's why I've always taught that salvation is not a noun. In your outline, the word is salvation. Salvation is not stagnant. It's not static. Salvation is a verb. It's not something that you did once as an act of a decision, and then Christ did something when he died and all of that. Salvation is active. It's something that should be going on in your life today. Because Christ is interceding for you today. Because he lives forever to make intercession for his people. Jesus, listen to me. Jesus, if you're a son of God, he's praying for you now. Did you know that? He's praying for you right now if you're one of his children. How can he do that? Well, he's God. He's the Son of God. He's part of the triune nature of God, with God, Son, and Holy Spirit all communicating together, all simultaneously, about billions upon billions and trillions of things. They think computers are good. They're nothing compared to God. So this intercession is his continual appearance for us in the presence of his Father. And because of his office, God's office is his high priesthood over the house of God. It says in the word that he is the high priest over the house of God. And that is a representation. That is a part of, remember that word, Irene, his efficacy. Remember we looked at that word a couple years ago. Efficacy merely means that he is efficient. His oblation, do you know what oblation means? That's one of those theological words that just means his bloodletting, oblation. Because of the efficacy of his oblation, combined with his care for you, combined with his love for you, combined with his desires for your welfare, combined with what he supplies you with, what he delivers you from, and he even, not only that for you individually, but he gives you a church corporately in which to worship him. All those things, he's doing all of those things all at once as he intercedes before his Father for you. He presents himself before his Father on your behalf, and by the representation of his death, his bloodletting, by the sacrifice he made for us, his Father accepts his payment for your sins tonight as he prays for you. So we're saved eternally by eternal prayers. Romans 8, 3 and 4 says that, if you want a place to look at it. And because of God's advocacy, 1 John 2, 1, because of God's the advocacy of Jesus as our high priest, 1 John 2, 1, he prays for us, and his prayers are answered because he prays perfectly on the basis of his perfect sacrifice. And the best thing about the whole thing, and you can tell your friend, God's waiting for everybody to come. God wants everybody to come. It's a wonderful thing that God knows come. All you got to do is come. That's all you got to do is come. Tell your friends. It says, draw near to me through my son, your high priest. Draw near to me. Draw near to me. Just come to me. God's word says if you come to him, he will not cast you out. For Christ is able to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession